Welcome, my friends, and buckle up as we dive into a story of misplaced praise and high-profile hypocrisies. Today's Royal Scoop focuses on none other than Harry and Meghan Markle, a duo that never fails to draw the limelight, for better or worse. Let's rewind a bit, shall we? A few months ago, Time magazine bestowed a rather exalted title upon our controversial couple, declaring them among the most influential people in the world. Their profile was a veritable tapestry of laudatory language, painting a picture of Harry and Meghan at the zenith of their influence. They were poised as the prodigal prince and princess of America, who'd been worshipped and venerated to such a degree that they seemed to be single-handedly shaking the foundations of the ancient British monarchy. Reading this grandiose ode, one might have believed they were on a limitless trajectory, basking in adoration, radiating power, and teetering on the precipice of billionairedom. But looking back on it now, I can't help but chuckle. It feels more like a slapstick comedy than a serious profile of two of the world's supposed most influential people. Yes, the difference between that lofty portrayal and where Harry and Meghan stand now is stark. It's a bit like comparing a regal swan to a rubber ducky. Both are technically birds, but one is clearly not like the other. To put it bluntly, their reality as it stands is far from the near mythic figures they were made out to be. And that's where the hilarity ensues. Those highfalutin words used by Time now seem almost like a parody, the height of pompous absurdity. I mean, can you imagine Meghan sitting there, her ego swelling to the size of Jupiter, or perhaps Uranus, depending on your choice of planet, as she read those lavishly spun tales about herself? I'm not exaggerating when I say it's comically surreal. But here's the real kicker. This isn't just about Harry and Meghan. It's a glaring reflection of a certain segment of elite media that seems adept at concocting these fantastical narratives. This incident exposes the underbelly of a world that trades authenticity for glossy PR facades. To me, the real tragedy here isn't Meghan's supposedly inflated ego or Harry's complicated relationship with the crown. No, the biggest disappointment is the unveiling of this charlatan-like PR game that we, the audience, are often made the pawns of. Meghan's fall from grace is just a symptom of a much larger issue in media and public relations, a system that prizes polished charades over uncomfortable truths. Friends, let's take a step back in time, specifically to an interview featuring our very own Duke of Sussex, Harry. Picture him, suited up in his military gear, stationed at an airfield in far-flung Afghanistan. The cameras are rolling, recording his commentary on the latest royal news, when suddenly, there's a bang. Soldiers scramble, and in a blur of motion, Harry stands up, yanks off his microphone, and bolts toward the action. This image, this portrayal of a noble prince charging headfirst into danger, it's powerful, isn't it? It sets the stage for a narrative that Harry and his Duchess Meghan are action-driven humanitarians, braving trials and tribulations to make the world a better place. Meghan, known for her advocacy for women and girls globally, is often framed as a complement to this image. Together, they're seen as a pair that doesn't just sit idle and enjoy their inherited privileges and fame. They're projected as hands-on changemakers, using their Archewell Foundation to turn compassion into action, give a voice to the voiceless, support mental health initiatives, and provide relief during natural disasters. Sounds inspiring, right? But let's pause for a moment. I can't help but wonder if this portrayal of the Sussexes is like watching a well-directed movie, where the heroes always triumph despite the odds. You see, according to military sources from the US and UK who shared Harry's base, as well as a frontline reporter, those adrenaline-filled moments captured on camera in Afghanistan were merely PR stunts. Harry apparently never qualified as an Apache pilot, nor did he see combat. When danger loomed, it seems Harry preferred the comforts of his private bunker, secured by Gurkhas, whiling away the hours with video games until the coast was clear. To me, it's like watching the popular high school couple who seemed to have it all but faltered once they stepped into the real world. Once untouchable icons of their senior year, Harry and Meghan now appear to be striving to regain the glory days, amidst whispers that their former popularity was bought, not earned, and that their school years were filled with more posing than actual substance. And then we have well-respected outlets like The New Yorker publishing what now appears to be a rather outdated and nauseatingly sycophantic narrative of the Sussexes. Just a few choice quotes from their pages serve as reminders of how mainstream media often propagates these glossy narratives, only for the truth to slowly trickle out and splash cold water on the carefully crafted image. Now, let's shift our gaze to an event that raised quite a few eyebrows. Remember when Meghan and Harry were asked to sit with the so-called minor royals during a royal gathering instead of standing on the balcony with the rest of the family? This incident, seen by some as a snub, was construed by others as a thinly veiled act of racism. Now, whether that's accurate or not, this is where the narrative starts to veer into questionable territory. The New Yorker, for instance, published an article that essentially condemned the royal family for this supposed act of racism. Yet, the question remains, is this an objective interpretation of events? Or is it another layer of that glossy PR narrative we've been talking about? And then there's the starry-eyed love story that The New Yorker spun last December, painting Harry and Meghan as a modern-day fairy tale couple destined to be together. In retrospect, it's hard not to chuckle at such a saccharine portrayal, especially in light of recent revelations. It appears that the outlet, like many others, was swept up in the allure of a good story, rather than a well-researched one. This brings us to another critical point. The progressive community, by and large, doesn't appreciate being used as a stepping stone for public image. Declarations about feminism, racism, and other social issues are serious matters that should not be taken lightly or used as PR fodder. And that's where we hit a roadblock with Meghan's proclaimed advocacy for women and humanitarian work. In all fairness, if we are to credit someone as a powerful advocate or a humanitarian, shouldn't we expect to see a record of their concrete achievements? I'm talking about tangible, irrefutable evidence of how many women she has helped reintegrate into the workforce, or how many girls her charity has kept in school. It's one thing to ride the wave of other organizations' hard work, hand out a pittance here and there, and take the credit for it. It's an entirely different thing to be directly involved and make a meaningful impact. Take the Grenfell cookbook, for instance. Meghan's contribution was limited to writing a foreword, yet she received credit as if she had been integral to the project. It's these discrepancies that can make one question the sincerity behind such gestures, prompting us to wonder, is it genuine advocacy? Or is it all just a well-crafted PR strategy? It's disheartening to hear about the lack of substance behind some of Meghan's claimed humanitarian efforts. Taking credit for designing a working wardrobe and bags for women returning to the workplace, when it was actually the result of a collective project, undermines the authenticity of her contributions. Similarly, distributing a few bags of supplies to sex workers with banana empowerment messages may be a kind gesture, but it doesn't necessarily establish a track record of impactful advocacy. And let's not forget the much-discussed 40x40 initiative on Meghan's 40th birthday, which garnered more eye rolls than genuine enthusiasm. It's understandable that people are questioning the true extent of her humanitarian and advocate credentials, as concrete evidence seems to be lacking. The critique extends beyond Meghan herself and raises broader questions about the state of journalism and the reliability of prestigious awards. One could argue that the press, at times, readily throws accolades without thoroughly verifying facts or assessing the actual results of these endeavors. The mention of the Nobel Peace Prize being awarded to President Obama based on future expectations, only to fall short when it came to actual peace-promoting achievements, underscores this point. As for Harry and Meghan's decision to hire PR press for their endeavors, it does raise eyebrows. It suggests that they are keenly aware of the importance of managing their public image and narrative. However, whether this indicates a lack of genuine talent or simply a strategic approach to navigating the media landscape is a matter of interpretation. Ultimately, the lack of concrete evidence and questionable practices raise valid concerns about the authenticity of the couple's advocacy work. It's important for individuals to critically evaluate the claims made by public figures and not simply accept them at face value. The truth should always be sought out, even if it challenges the carefully constructed narratives we encounter.